This video is going to cover chapter 9 or 9.1. This will be part 1 for chapter 9 on subnetting IP networks. And chapter 9 is going to have three parts to it. We're going to talk about subnetting an IPv4 network, addressing schemes, and then design considerations for IPv6. So the links at the end of this video at the bottom right-hand corner should take you to the 9.2 and 9.3. Okay, so for chapter nine, we're going to be looking at explaining why routing is necessary for hosts on different networks to communicate. What's the difference between, why we have routing essentially, and what the routing does for us from the subnetting standpoint. We're going to look at describing IP as a communication protocol. Given a network and a subnet mask, we can calculate the number of host addresses available and calculate the necessary subnet mask in order to accommodate the requirements of a network. We're going to look at VLSM, or variable length subnet masking. We're going to take a look at IPv6 address assignments and how they're implemented in a business network. Okay, so why do we subnet? And these are the reasons we subnet. We have, in networking, we can control broadcast traffic with subnet work. So we can, we don't have all the traffic talking to each other. Back when networking first started, we had, and I'm going to go ahead and go to the next slide here, and so I can get an example here. So back when we just had switches, or even before switches, we just had hubs, or we had just computers networked together, all that traffic would be seen by all the other computers. And so what subnetting allows us to do, or with subnet masking and subnetting, it allows us to take those networks and divide them up or subnetwork those out. And so we have segmentations or network segments on there. And that was the wonderful Windows update there, reminding me that I had updates. So we had, with subnetting, it allows us to break those networks up so we don't have as much traffic, and it does provide a little bit of security on that. Not full security, but it does allow some security that we can keep networks from seeing each other, essentially. So we can communicate, though, between subnets, and to do that, we need routing. And so a router is necessary for devices to be able to talk to each other when we're using different subnets, because the way IP addressing works, especially with an IPv4, when we break those down on a different subnet and a different subnet mask, those computers cannot see each other unless they're on the same subnetwork. So we have to have routing to do that. So the title here is fundamental that they are showing. Subnetting is, I don't know, would call it fun. It's interesting, and you can do it on paper. I have videos on how to do that, and I'll put links down here at the bottom of this video that'll take you to those on how to do subnetting, basic subnetting, advanced subnetting, and then there's three videos in all that you'll want to do. And if you're in doing the playlist for these PowerPoint videos, I'll have those in the playlist. I believe those are the first of the videos, so you should be able to scroll back up. But if you have any questions about finding those videos, just leave a comment down in the video, and I'll point you to those. So when we subnet, basic subnetting, and again, I encourage you to go watch the subnetting videos that I've done, because those will show you how to do subnetting. And I'm not going to teach you here, because this is the more of the technical way to do it. I'm going to talk about it here for a few minutes, but just for sake of the length of this video, I have created other videos that do this for you. You can find lots of videos out on the internet on subnetting, various different ways to do it. I have come up with the way that I have found simple to do it, and so that's why I did the videos originally, so that I could show students how to do it the easy way, or the way I found to be easy. But essentially, what we're doing with the subnetwork is we have our IPv4 address here, and let's just say that this first address here is 192.168.1.0. And our subnet mask is 255.255.255. And if you have learned binary by now, you should. 255 in our subnet mask means that all eight of those there are going to be ones. Those are going to be ones. And when we get over here, these are going to be zeros. And so what happens is when the router reads that IP address, and it reads the subnet mask, and it comes across and it sees all these ones in here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And it reads those. And then it comes to this next digit and it reads a zero. It says, oh, okay, this subnet mask is 255, 255, 255. So anybody, any IP address that falls within this range right here can see each other. They can communicate with each other. But if that IP range falls in this area, that's the host portion and they cannot see each other. So if you've got an IP that's outside that, so all the ones that have that are similar here are going to be able to see each other. But if you have a number that's changed, let's say that this is 2, 192.168.2 is not going to be able to see a 192.168.1 because inside this range here there's a different number. But if they're the same over here, they'll be able to see each other. And so hopefully that's understandable there. So let's look down here at the subnet 0. So subnet 0, when we subnet, then we are going to borrow bits from the subnet mask, and we're, instead of having 255, 255, 255, 0, we're going to borrow a bit. And again, I encourage you to go watch the videos because those are going to help you explain or help explain to you how to do and why we do subnetting. But let's say we borrow our bit and we go from a slash 24 to a slash 25, that subnet mask becomes dot 128. So now any numbers, any IP addresses that fall from 0 to 127 can communicate with each other because they're on the same subnet. Any IP addresses that go from 128, which is the next digit, to 255 are going to be able to see each other. But computers are not going to be able to see each other here. There's a block there. They cannot see each other unless there's some type of routing that takes place, some type of routing that the router will be able to say, yes, 192.168.1.128 is trying to talk to 192.168.1.125, and they'll be able to pass back and forth because it's going to translate that. So hopefully you're getting the understanding of why when we subnet, we do what we do. So again, go watch the videos, which will explain how to do it. This is the why we do it. So when we put it in use, when we put subnetting in use here, these are our ranges. So we're going to say we're going to subnet mask and we're going to subnet this into 4. So when we borrow the bits, and again, the videos are going to show you how to do that. This is the why. But when we do the slash 25, we're going to get 4 hosts out of this. We're going to get 4 subnets out of this. I said that wrong. We're going to get 4 subnets out of that. And when we get those 4 subnets out of each range there, so subnet 0 is 0 to 127. And so we have 1 to 1, 126, 127. And remember here, or I'm sorry, not 4. And I said that wrong there. We're not looking at 4 hosts or 4 subnets. We're looking at 2 subnets here. We've got our subnet 0 and our subnet 1 here. So what we have done is we have subnetted this into 2. We've borrowed 1 bit. And by borrowing 1 bit, that's 2 to the first power, so that'll give us 2 subnets. And when we have our 2 subnets, then we have our subnet 0 and our subnet 1. And on that, out of each one of these, we are going to lose 2 IP addresses. Or we don't lose them, but they're not usable. So out of each subnet that we create, we're going to lose 2 IP addresses. One of them we're going to lose to the host network address. So the first IP or the first number is our network address, and that's always that. Our last one is our broadcast address, and you're going to learn that in more networking classes. Down the road, you're going to learn that about the networking address and the broadcast address, and we've covered that in other videos, and we cover that in other areas of the course. But your network address is what the network uses to let us know what that network is or what that that range is, and then our broadcast address is for our broadcasting to the entire subnet, and then our range is then from 1 to 126, 1 to 126, which is this number here, so 1 to 126. And our other subnet goes from 128, see, that's our next number in line, but that becomes our network address, and then our 255 is our broadcast address, and then we have a range from 129 to 254 that we can use in that subnet to assign to devices. Or whatever we're deciding, you know, whether it's printers or a host, we call them host at this point. Okay, so when we subnet and when we do the calculation And I'm going to say it again, go watch the videos, and I'll put a link here for you to watch the videos on how to subnet. This is the more technical way to do it. I've got a simple way to do it on the videos, and they break it down in about 10 minutes. And I searched for a long time trying to figure out how to subnet and come up with a number of different ways and just kind of mashed them together. And that's the way I know how to do it. And I can do it on paper. I don't need a calculator. It makes it, you don't need a lot of math skills. It just makes it very simple to do that. But when we're, just for the sake of the slide here, when you want to calculate the number of your subnets, if you need your subnets, and n is where your n bits are borrowed. So if we borrow one bit, it's 2 to the first power, so you get 2 subnets. If we borrow 2 bits, or 7 bits remaining, so that gives us, that's our host, that's how we calculate our host. So our number of our subnets and our number of our host, if we borrow one bit, it's 2 to the first power, or 2 to whatever power. So 2 to 1 is 2 to subnets. And then we have 7 bits remaining to 2 to the 7th power is 128 host. 128 host on there. So, and it just, and you could continue on from there. So 2 to the 2nd power, you would get 4 subnets. And then that would leave you a remainder of 6 bits. And then so it would be 2 to the 6th power. And that would give you your remaining host left as well. Okay, so if we borrow 2 bits, we're going to create 4 subnets. So 2 to the 2nd power equals 4 subnets. We borrowed 2 bits. This was our original mask, and now we've broken it down into 4 subnets because we borrowed 2 bits. Our first one is 00, the second one 01, then 10, and then 11. Those are our leading IP addresses, or that's the same, that they all use the same subnet mask of 192, and we're using 192 because 255, 255, 255, and then 128. Plus 64 is 192. Okay, so that gives us our 192, and all of these have a subnet mask of 192. So that tells any router or anybody looking at this that we have 4 subnets, and our first IP address on the one here is 0, and the last one is 26. So our network ID is 0, our broadcast is 26. Network ID is 64, broadcast is 26, 128, 26, and 192, or I'm sorry, so that's slash 26, excuse me. And I had that wrong. I'm looking at the wrong number here. Let me erase this. Okay, so our first IP address is 0, and that's our network. And our last one is 63, because C64 here is our first IP address here. So 63 is our broadcast, and this one is our network. And then we have 64 here, which is our network. And then our next one would be 127, which that's our broadcast. And then 128 is our network. And then what's our broadcast? That is 191, because that's the one right before that. And then this is our network. And then 255 is our broadcast, because we know that's the ending. If all 8 numbers, the whole octet's filled with ones, then that's a 255. So that's how you can see what your network and your broadcast ID are, just really quickly by looking at these. And then that also shows you how you break that down. And again, my video shows you how to do all that calculation as well. So let's say if we're going to create 8 subnets. So we need to borrow 3 bits now. So we're borrowing 3 bits, and that creates 8 subnets. And how do we know that? Because 2 to the 3rd power is 8 subnets. On my video, I show you the chart on how to do that. In fact, I keep saying that. I'm gonna pull the chart up here real quick and show you how to do that. Okay, so let's take a look here at this is the chart, and you can draw this out. And if you watch the video again, I show you how to draw this chart. But this, you can handwrite your chart out. If you start with this one right here, start with this row right here, and if you just write 1 and double it every time until you get up to 128, so 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, 128, everybody can do that in their head. You can write it out on a piece of paper. So you start with this line right here, and then you do this one first. Do that one first, and then I always start on the number of subnetworks next, and so then I start at 2. So we know that if we borrow one bit right here, we're going to get 2 subnets. Okay, so I start with 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, 128, 256. So that's the second one you do right there. And then what I do is I come up here to the top and I say, okay, if I borrow one bit is 128. Because that's the place value for the binary is 128. because right here, see, we have the binary. So binary is 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, 128. So this is the 128 place. And our subnet mask, how to easily calculate that is every time we borrow a bit, we just add the binary number in there. So 128 plus 64 is 192. So that's 2 bits. 128 plus 64 plus 32 is 224 and so forth. And then plus 16 is 240. And it's as simple as that. And then this is our place values here, 25, 26, 27, 28, all the way across. So this simple chart right here is your gold mine for subnetting. This is your golden ticket, or this is the easy way to do subnetting. And if you use this chart right here and you start and you go 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32 all across, go start with 2 and go back across, and then just fill in your places and then do your numbers right here. Whenever I'm taking an exam or taking a certification or anything that's going to have subnetting in it, I write down on my whiteboard or my piece of paper, I write this chart down, because then I don't have to do any calculations in my head. I don't need any extra stress when I'm taking a test. And so I write this down, and this comes in very handy. When you go to take your Cisco certification, you want to write this down as the first thing, because you might be able to do it in your head, and some people can do that. I get nervous and I have trouble with numbers in my head, so I write this down, and it's a lifesaver as far as when it comes to exam time. Okay, let's go back to the PowerPoint. Okay, so we have our four subnets here. We borrowed 3 bits, and so that gives us 8 subnets. And you can just look down through this. This is our first 3 right here, and then you can see where we borrowed. You know, our first numbers are network, and then we have our first number in our range, and then we have our last number in our range, and then we have our broadcast, and then it just goes all the way down. On there, and then how it's applied in. And then we have our 4, 5, 6, 7, and on to 8. Or excuse me, that's 8, because we start with 0. Remember, 0 is a number. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Or they call it network 7. So in the networking world, you have that one, your network 0. And then you apply them, your subnet allocation. Okay, and then the last chart I want to show you here, this is considerations when planning subnets. So your number of subnets required and your number of hosts required gives you a formula to determine the number of usable hosts. And there's a mathematical calculation you can do on here. So 2 to the nth power, where n is your number of the host bits remaining, and that's used to calculate the number of hosts. And then minus 2 gives you your number of usable hosts, because remember, you have to have a network ID and a broadcast ID, so you're going to lose 2 numbers, one to the broadcast and 1 to the network. So if you go 2 to the n power, that's going to do that. Now, let me go back to my chart again, and I'm going to show you how it's handy to calculate using that chart. So using our chart here, you can come across and you can say, okay, how many hosts am I going to get by borrowing each one? Now, again, this is the reason I love this chart, because if I borrow 1 bit, I know I'm going to get 2 hosts. Okay, and out of that, I'm going to get 126 usable, or excuse me, let me re-say that. I'm going to get 2 subnetworks. I'm going to get 2 subnetworks. Let me redraw that. I'm going to get 2 subnetworks, and then I'm going to get 126 usable hosts. And it's 126 because I have a minus 2. Remember, one's going to go to the network, and one's going to go to the broadcast. If I borrow 3 bits on my chart here, and I've been, let's just say I've been given a question to say I need to borrow 4 bits. I need a subnet with at least 12 hosts per subnet. I need them at least 12 per subnet. Okay, so I can come onto my little chart right here, and I can say, okay, I need 12 hosts, at least 12 hosts. Well, this one's going to fit the range because this one's too many, and this one's going to give me 12 hosts. So I can just say, okay, I know I'm going to get 14 out of there. So I'm going to get 16 subnets with 14 hosts per subnet, usable hosts per subnet. And that's, again, why I like this chart, because it makes it nice and easy. If I borrow, let me see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5, I'm going to get 6 usable hosts per subnet and 32 subnets. So hopefully you can see the power of this chart here, where instead of doing the math with the 2 to the n power and doing all those calculations, especially on an exam, where if you write this chart out, it really comes in handy for you. Okay, so here's how you can do it with the math, and then you can also do it with the chart. So when we're calculating it out, we can calculate the number of subnets. So the formula is 2 to the nth power, where n is the number of bits borrowed. And then you can see your subnet per per subnet. And so in the real world, we're going to say, we're going to be given a question and we're going to say, we want 40 hosts here, 20 hosts here, 20 hosts here, and 20 hosts here, and 15 hosts here. So that lets us create the number of hosts. So we need at least 5 subnets, 3, 4, 5, and we need at least a minimum of 40 on there. So we need 5 with at least 40. So if we pull our chart up, we're going to look at our chart here, and we're going to say on our chart, we need at least 40 hosts, and we need at least 8 subnets. So we need at least 40. So that one's not going to come into play. So we can't get 40 out of that one. We're only going to be able to get 30 out of that one and 8 subnets. But here we need 5 subnets and see, we're only going to get 4 out of that. And that's going to give us 62. So we've got a little bit of a dilemma, and that's what we're going to talk about in part 2 of the video, is how we do variable length subnet masking. So what we're going to do is we're going to conclude this video right here. And we're going to talk about variable length subnet masking in part 2.